Good evening. We want to welcome everybody who is watching this or listening this, as tonight we want to celebrate the life of Soraya Medina. Soraya Medina is an important member of the community who recently passed away, and many people in the community were personally affected because of all the great work and contribution that she made to her community and to her family. Tonight, we're very honored to be joined by members of her family and her community who wanted to help tell a story and present a complete picture of who Soraya Medina was and why she was such a powerful and small package here in Los Angeles, and why so many people will be missing her for the rest of their lives. We have a wonderful group of people that are here with us today, and I'll be going around asking you to introduce yourself. So if you don't mind unmuting yourself, we're gonna start at the top of the screen there with Marisol. Can you please introduce yourself and say hello?
Hi, good evening. My name is Marisol Crisostomo-Romo. And I am a homegirl and a friend and a sister of Soraya. We connected both being half Filipina from Northeast LA, kind of a rare find, definitely a gem. We were just two peas in a pod. I miss her dearly, and I'm just honored to be here and share with everyone.
Thank you for joining us. Yaneth, can you please introduce yourself and tell us about your connection to Soraya?
Good evening, everybody. I am also honored to be here. My name is Yaneth Rodriguez, and I am also a friend of Soraya. And I also had I was honored to be able to dance Danza Azteca with Soraya as well. I've known Soraya for many, many years, even before I started dancing Danza Azteca. Back in about 2000 when I met her, later we re-met again through Danza. So I've known Soraya for many years, and definitely a sister that I love very much. Thank you.
Sounds good. Lili, can you please say hello and introduce yourself?
Hi, my name is Lili Flor. I'm grateful to be here today. Thank you for opening up space for all of us. And I know Soraya since she was probably like 16 years old, 1995, when she was living in Rampart area around that time, I think. Through the years, you know, through political activism, we connected not only through family first, but then eventually in political activism. Then I saw her around, and we just bonded automatically. We're like very connected in so many ways, being the black sheep of the family in many aspects, and just treating each other with respect. Growing up together. So we grew up together in El Movimiento, in the movement of circles, of social justice circles, and also in ceremony, as well as the dancing, nightclubs, and social events, and art, and culture, and every aspect pretty much of my growing up. And so she is definitely a part of my family as well. So that's how I know Soraya.
And I think we'll attempt to demonstrate what a complete human being Soraya is and was. And so the next person I'd like to introduce himself is Sonji. Can you please say hello, Sonji?
Hello. My name is Sonji. I'm a muralist and an artist from Los Angeles. And I met Soraya when she had Bohemia Books in MacArthur Park. And our lives have brought us back and forth in and out of each other's lives from then till now. Since I've moved from the US, our relationship evolved into her checking in with me, asking me if I'm eating right, if I'm okay, if I'm missing home. And then Cindy would go on her travels and pit stop here. So then her calls included, hey, make sure my mom is eating okay. and keep an eye on her. Don't lose mom. which made me feel hella responsible for mom every time she stopped by here. Soraya, she inspired a lot of the artists to keep painting. She inspired a lot of the women to just keep talking shit and to be loud. And one of my earliest memories of Soraya was in MacArthur Park when Tishnan Hot, I don't know how to say his name, but he came and did a silent meditative walk around the park. And I was talking, and then she quickly just turned around and said, Sonji, shut the fuck up. We're supposed to be walking in prayer right now. All right? Okay, my bad. And we just kept walking in prayer, and that was one of my first experiences with her. And I felt like, oh, Yuri and I are gonna be friends for a long time. She didn't belong to any particular group or circle in LA. She belonged to all of LA. And that's how I see her, a hummingbird from Highland Park to South Central Farm to the Bakersfield Farm to East LA to Mid-City, Koreatown, she was always there.
Absolutely, she was a little powerful hummingbird. I think I met her at the South Central Farm, so thank you for that. Yeah. Richi Panta, can you please introduce yourself for the audience?
Hi everyone, good evening. My name is Richard Panta. And I was lucky enough to be in a in LA's premier bomba group, Puerto Rican, Afro-Puerto Rican music called Atabe with Soraya. And so my connection with her has always been through music. I didn't know that she liked, I'm in a band that she really liked too. So I was lucky enough to be able to play with that band at a fundraiser for her. I think it was the last gig we did before the pandemic hit. And I'm happy to be here and to share that. Those times with all of you guys.
Thank you. Lizette, you've known her for a very long time. What can you tell us about your friend, Soraya?
Sure. First of all, I just want to say thank you to Miguel and also Soraya's family for bringing us together and allowing us to share space. I met her back in about, I was thinking like 98, 99, somewhere around there. Around the Old City Jail times, and it was basically a very time. It was just a time that we were all forming, you know, our political views. We were all finding our place in LA and in society. We were all looking for you know, our spiritual communities. So it was during that time that we met, and over the years, we've sort of like, you know, weaved back and forth. You know, at some point, you know, she became a single mom, so did I. So over the last few years in particular, we've picked up our political work. And so I'll be talking about that a little bit later, but some of the work around Puerto Rico, around TJ, her work in Watts, you know, and just in South LA in general. So she touched a lot of different people. And then of course we had our parties, you know, and all that sort of stuff. And just, she was just someone that I think that she believed in each of us, you know? And so just like right now, I might be a little bit nervous, you know, for a number of reasons, but I could just hear her saying, "You're the baddest bitch in town," you know? Like she just would say that kind of stuff to all of us to just pump us up and keep us going.
Absolutely. Mano, tell us about your friend Soraya.
Oh, wow. She was something to behold. The very moment I met her was in the Centro Regeneración on Avenue 58 in Highland Park, like mid-90s, 95. And I'm, you know, it's like, instantly it's like, who is this person? Like, she's so interesting. So you can see the dopeness in her and the soul this little package had of a person. You know, she's small but mighty force. And that was the first impression. I mean, yes, and she had a beautiful face, and I'm like, the personality of a of a skate punk, rockera, hip hop head, stoner chick, you know, everything that was cool about her. That's the instant moment you get from Soraya. And she made everybody feel like she was her your best friend. Like, that's, you know, her legacy right there.
Sounds good. Sienna, can you please introduce yourself for our audience?
Hi, I'm Sienna. I'm her oldest daughter. And I just wanted to say thank you for creating this opportunity. And it's really great to hear everyone's stories because there are a lot of perspectives that I never saw of my mom. So it's really nice to hear all these stories from everyone. So I'm excited.
Thank you for joining us. We're very honored to have you here. Neo, would you like to introduce yourself and introduce your mama or help her introduce herself as well?
Yeah, so my mom had trouble with Zoom, so she's actually on speaker with me. I'm Neo Medina. I am Soraya's brother. I am her little big brother, her protector in many ways. Once I surpassed her in height in my teenage years, I felt like she was my little sister, but she was definitely my first teacher. Taught me so much. She was an amazing person, and it's been very difficult for our family. I can't thank you guys enough, everybody, for coming out and being a part of this, and hearing all the good stories about her has been great. It's helping us heal. You know, Soraya is definitely a tough cookie. She's a piece of dynamite, you know, big bang in a small package. And you got to credit me and my brother Omar for that, because we punked her a lot when we were younger. We definitely pushed her to the edge. We grew up in some very tough neighborhoods, and that's where we get our strength from. You know, Rampart District, Hoover Street, Koreatown, Highland Park, you name it. Like, we've been around LA. We've been through many different diverse areas, and we've struggled with my tough mom. You know, my mom was a single mother working in downtown LA for 33 years for the same job. And, you know, a lot of my sister is in my mother, and I thank my mom for that. Mom, did you want to say something?
I'm so emotional. How could I compress 42 and a half years of her life into a couple of sentences? I'm grateful for the people who are honoring her. I see a lot of her from a different perspective, but at the same time, the things that she's doing was to learn from me what I learned from my mom and my grandparents. So she just amplified it. It's like throwing a stone in a pond and the ripples get bigger and bigger. So it still boggles me. And I feel the love of the people who knew her and even thanked me. I feel like I'm not worthy. Like, what? She did a lot of that all by herself, but I do have the credit for her Puerto Rican genes and the Filipino genes, you know, because I always, even though things went sour with her dad and me, I always told her to honor her Puerto Rican heritage and the Filipino heritage, never forget, because at least twice a year we make pernil, coquito, tostones, all this Puerto Rican food, December and January 6th. And then in June, there's the Philippine Independence Day, Puerto Rican Independence Day, Cuban. So, and of course, most of the year we're Mexican, so it's very multicultural. I love the Latino concept of being family and having the children always included in a circle. Everything is so family oriented. That's what makes me relate to a lot of the Latino culture, because we love our kids. We don't leave them behind. We put them in the circle. We're doing, like when I was with the union, the AFT, I worked for the community college district. So as a delegate, Soraya and my kids would be sitting on the laps of union heads. I mean, they're, you know, the great leaders. And then a foot away, somebody would play music, or there's a clown. And then somebody would ask me to dance, all within 2 feet around my children. Where else could I get that? Plus, I get a lot of direct stuff from the movers and shakers of the lawmakers of California, sometimes the whole national thing. So all that maybe she absorbed and then some, because later on she started going to Sacramento too. So our circles kind of intersect each other. Like she meet somebody, she introduced me to him, and I'm already talking. She said, "Oh, you already met my mom? Since we don't look alike, you know, I'm 50 pounds more than her." People that I'm Asian and she's more Latino. So, "Oh, you're related?" And she said, "Yeah." So anyway, I'm very proud of her. Of course, as mother and daughter, we don't always agree on a lot of stuff, but she puts a lot of perspective in things. When I used to kind of scold her, when I say, "Raya," and then when I talk to Neil, she said, "Mom, do you realize that the way you're talking to me and the way you're talking to my little brother is so different?" Like, I didn't realize that. And then as a single parent, I kind of lost my sense of being a woman. She would remind me, she would buy me a $6 lipstick at the time when I was just content with a 50 cent lipstick at Woolworth. He said, "Mom, you gotta wear, you know, lipstick so your lips don't crack, you know, and it's makes it bigger." She always like look at me as a female. Me, I just look at myself as a parent. And sadly, a lot of us single mothers, we tend to lose who we are, but Soraya, she kind of reminds me.
Anyway, that's great,
I don't
want
to take up more of your time.
We'll have more time. Thank you, Mom.
We wanted to say thank you for sharing her with us. And if you don't mind sharing a little bit about her, the day she was born, what was that like?
Oh, my God. She's incredible. She was born in Washington State while I was in the military. And there, they opened the curtains where everybody can look at you. But when she was born, after she was cleaned up, they put the baby on the mother's stomach, on my stomach. She opened her eyes and looked at me. And this thrill of like, wow, what an amazing human being, you know, came from me. But she was like that, even when she was like 9 months old. One time I was in Puerto Rico, I was so frustrated because trying to relate to a new country, then I was military, now I'm non-military, then I missed my mom. It was like Mother's Day, I missed my mom even though I'm a mom. And I was actually like frustrated. She was trying to chase, she was in a walker, a bamboo walker, and she was trying to chase a little chihuahua. And the chihuahua was running away from her because she gets run over. So when Soraya chased her in the walker, she tumbled over to the grass. And she was crying, not because she was hurt, she was crying because she couldn't get to the dog. But me, I was crying. I picked her up and I started bringing her upstairs. And I was crying like a baby. And can you believe she rolled around and started patting my head like it was gonna be okay. She was probably 7 or 8 months old, you know, when you're trying to walk. And she was treating me like I was her baby. And I didn't remember that until only a week ago, because like the first 7 days of her transition, 9 days, I was not attached to reality. I had no sense, no perception, but as each day passes, I have more sleep. I start remembering things that I haven't thought of like in 40 years, but she was an incredible young lady. Even when Neil and Omar were only like 7 and 9, so Soraya's probably 11. And she would help me when I come from the office. She would say, "Mom, why don't you rest? I'll take care of the boys." She's only like 16 months older than her next sibling. So she was always, we have a lot of role reversal. And I encouraged it.
That's great, Mom.
She's a very special human being. Thank you. Thank you very much for sharing that with us.
Thank you.
I wanted to ask you, Neil, so who is Soraya Medina, and at what point did you realize that you were related to the godmother?
Well, I'll tell you my first memory of my sister. It's probably one of my earliest memories, and I, you know, that I can think of, just thinking about the first apartment that we lived in Hoover. It was close to Lafayette Park. The birthplace of MS-13. It was a very tough time. My earliest memory was her screaming at me. She was screaming at me because I was a curious little kid and I was off the wall, and I was probably 3 or 4 years old, and I was standing in front of a pool, and I was tossing a cat into a pool, and actually it was a kitten. I wanted to see this kitten swim, and this kitten was swimming back to me. So every time it swam back to me, I would toss it back in. And I didn't realize at the time that, you know, that was wrong. And so my sister knew it was wrong, but she ran off, and I think she ran off to go tell my mom or my dad to confirm if it was wrong. So she came back to me and said, "Neil, that's wrong." And, you know, that was her. That was her basically there for me at a time in my life when I didn't know right or wrong. I didn't know life or death. You know, my sister is such a fighter and such a teacher. She's always had fight in her. Like, we always had... almost every window in our house was broken, because when I pissed her off or my brother Omar pissed her off, she would grab the first thing that was next to her and chuck it at us. So we always had broken windows in these slumlord apartments. They never fixed them. It was always cold. We always had to board it up with cardboard. But just to kind of give you guys an example of how she was in our teenage years. I stopped wearing jewelry. My dad lived in Florida at the time, and he would send us, he'd send me like a watch and a few bucks on my birthday. And I stopped wearing watches going to school because we grew up in some really bad neighborhoods, because I would get jacked all the time. And, One time me and my sister were walking to somewhere. We were walking out of the neighborhood, and I saw an older guy that had jacked me before, and he yelled at me from about, I'd say, 75 or 100 yards away, and he was telling me to come here as he was approaching us. I never liked to run off, even if I was in trouble, and I told my sister to run off while I would handle this, because he was known for jacking younger kids, and I had already been a victim of him. I had already been, you know, in skirmishes with him, and my sister refused. She said, "No, I stand right here beside you." And I didn't walk up to him. I told her to run off. I told her she was so stupid. And that's just how she was. She waited there until he came up to us. You know, I tried talking to him and he wouldn't have it. And he got the best of me. And He ended up ripping a chain off her neck, but she stood there proud to stand with me. And that's just the type of person she was. You know, she was very strong willed, and she was a fighter, and she always stood up for what was right.
Can you talk a little bit about her establishing or helping establish La Culebra and what that fight was like?
Absolutely. Once we moved out of the Rampart District area, we actually lived like three blocks from Tommy's on Rampart. We moved to Highland Park on Avenue 57, about a block away from La Culebra. It was about 1992. The riots had just ended. And we narrowly escaped, you know, living in the bad area of Koreatown and Rampart District, because it was really bad in that area. The Koreans were getting robbed, or they were getting, you know, they were getting broken into by the rioters. And so we narrowly escaped that. Arts Corla was in development to have more open green space. And La Culebra was the very first one for Arts Corla's green space program. And we were lucky enough to be involved in that. It was just a dump. It was a dump, a neighborhood dump, where people would just throw tires and couches, and it was a slope. So we actually dug with our blood, sweat, and tears into that place and terraced it and planted that tree that you see around the Culebra. And I'm proud to say that, you know, we were a part of that. We've seen it grow. But that was a safe haven for us. It was a place that we can go. We could do after school work programs. We would, you know, I say we, but my sister would reach out to, she would be part of a program that would teach cooking classes and get some of the neighborhood mothers out to learn how to stretch their dollar. You know, learning different art forms. That's where she picked up danzante, and she was always a part of, you know, everything that they had to offer. We were on the street. We were street kids. You know, we stayed out till it was nighttime. I mean, I'm proud to say that we were the last generation that played outside. But that place gave us a place to be a part of the community in a big way. It saved us, you know. A neighborhood like that could have swallowed us up, like it did a lot of people. We've seen a lot of people that passed away, people involved in the gangs. A lot of 57 was very dangerous at that time too. It was just a beautiful place to be, because I learned my hard work from that place, and I still cherish that, because I am a extremely hard worker, and I don't like commanding orders without being part of it. And you know, we dug our hands deep in the earth in that place, and my sister learned a lot of community involvement, and she had a lot of pride, and we did a lot of community service there.
In the Zapatista movement, I know they call it mandar obedeciendo, and I think Soraya, with her mighty, mighty power, definitely mandaba obedeciendo, right? Yeah. The next question is for Lizette. I wanted to ask you, Lizette, since you've known Soraya for 25 years, I was hoping you'd talk a little bit about her evolution and how you saw her evolve from, you know, a young person to the beautiful human being that she became.
Sure. And I don't think it was quite 25 years, I first met her. We actually had just been talking about that this year. She had spent last New Year's Eve over at my house, actually, with my mom and my son and I, and you know, we were kind of going down memory lane, talking about how we would go to all these gigs over at the Old City Jail. This was during the time where I guess groups like Blues Experiment, Aslan Underground, Yitzhak. They were all sort of like garage bands or, you know, neighborhood bands at the time, right? Now, I wasn't from that part of LA, but, you know, it sort of had a lot of folks gravitating towards that area, right? So she, from what I understand, was putting together some of those shows as well back then. Over time, I met her also through the bookstore that she had. You know, many of us had been sort of grounded in either the Zapatista political movement or through ceremony or, you know, but basically we were part of, I think, of a generation of folks that wanted to kind of like decolonize ourselves and our families, if you will, right? And so we all took that commitment to different levels. Some of us became teachers, some of us became union organizers. And I think, you know, in her life, she really, I think, embodied like creating the revolution in and of herself. Like she didn't want to necessarily fit in a particular mold. And that's been really difficult, you know, for a lot of us to hold, you know, and I think a lot of us have many contradictions for whatever reasons, right? Some of us had to, whatever, not be able to do that kind of work, whereas she stayed committed, you know, that whole time. And I also met her through the health promotora work that she did, where she worked with a variety of organizations talking to families about toxins in your homes, right? So whether it be in plastics or in house cleaning supplies or, you know, just in paint and lead and whatnot. So she was part of that movement. She would ask me about those sorts of issues, but I honestly felt like she was more of an expert because she had a lot of the practical knowledge, you know, and she also embodied that in her home, from what I understand all this time. And I think that because, like, you know, as Cindy was saying, you know, and the rest of her family embodied like a multicultural sort of roots, which is kind of like my family, she really connected with different parts of LA, you know, so, and she wanted to make sure that it was connected to other movements. So some of the work that she did was also, I believe, in the food justice work. She worked on homelessness issues, I think, with a few folks and providing sort of on the ground health services in Skid Row area with a few collaborators. She also worked with some restaurants like Local, I believe, over in Watts. And what we had also done together is back, I believe, in 2017, when, you know, 45 had just gotten elected and that whole fiasco with, you know, with the hurricane and him throwing, you know, all those toilet paper rolls out, all that, there was a lot of mobilization nationally. So she was part of that. There was a series of events that we had, you know, one was at the federal building. We also had a bomba presentation in Watts, and it was like an exchange with some of the community folks from Watts who cared about environmental issues but wanted to know more about what was going on in Puerto Rico, you know. And so, like, so there was that. And then she also supported, like, you know, the Central American refugee movement, right? So she would hit me up about that since I'm Central American. And we did, we were part of a medical brigade from LA to TJ. So we went back in, I believe, 2018. And I remember, like, one time, like, someone had warned us, you know, if you park in this area, your car, because we had, she wanted to drive in her car. So we're like, all right, let's go in your car. So, someone had told us that, you know, if you park your car even for an hour or whatever, it's going to get broken into. And we wanted to catch this, like, impromptu rally that had just been forming. It was beautiful. It was deep. So we're like, we're just going to leave it here for like half an hour and like go catch that rally, right? And sure enough, we came back and the window in the back was popped. And, you know, me and my other friend were like, man, like, that, I mean, we were kind of tripping because it happened so fast. And she was just like, she wasn't sweating it at all. She's like, it's all good. I ain't tripping. Like, you know, and she just, she was just hella down, you know, and I think that, yeah, and also through the farm, I remember meeting Cindy there several times, you know, so just, you know, I think that we could possibly do a Soraya segment, you know, like, I think she has touched so many lives, so many organizations, that, you know, I think there's many lessons that can be embodied in the legacy that is being built for her. And I just feel very blessed. You know, we didn't always agree on a few things either, to be honest. But, you know, if, you know, I don't know, I feel like, you know, we definitely, you know, were very honest with each other. And I feel like she was just an amazing part of my life, and I'll never forget her, and I treasure her. So thank you to the family again.
Man, oh man, how is it that so many people had so much love for Soraya, and how does she make all of y'all feel like you were her best friend? How does she do that?
The cosmos gave her this gift, that her genes, her mother, her father, her ancestors, just it all came together in this small, beautiful package, that the human that we knew as Soraya. And for whatever reason, their environment and her, and as her brothers had stated, it all formed this unique, wonderful person that we, like, everybody from doctors to people living off the street could just relate to her and feel like, call that person a friend. And yeah, that's exactly what she was for me, and will continue to always be in my heart. You know, she's now one of the ancestors, and we will look for her in the future, I guess. But I'm just happy to have had that moment where she came in, a homegirl, Jennifer Sanchez, walked in with her. They, I guess, coming from danza, and or going to practice, and it was just like, from that moment on, it's like, this person, I have to know this person. She's just a great person, and extent is a reflection of her family too. Happy to be friends with the family for a while now. So much love.
Thank you, Mano. The next question is for Sonji, and then we're going to take a little break to hear some words actually from Soraya. But Sonji, what would you want the people to know about your friend and fellow artist, Soraya?
Okay, so I just wrote this. Soraya was the sun and we were the flowers. She was loving and angry. She laughed and screamed. She was a free spirit that adopted friends everywhere she went. She was perfectly imperfect. She loved her community, but she belonged only to herself. And we were all blessed to have spent the time we did with her. And her sunshine is always gonna be with us.
Oh, that's beautiful. Thank you for sharing that. That's really beautiful. Is there anything else you'd like to share about your homegirl and fellow artist and how she rocked it? But if you'd like to have us move on, that's cool.
I don't know. I feel like, as far as myself, I was a street kid too myself, you know, we raised ourselves, and I feel like she adopted a lot of us strays. I like calling that, we're strays, and we build our own community with each other, and we choose who our family are. And I'm just so grateful that I was part of those strays that she collected. Mm. And I was so grateful that she just, I never had anybody that cared about me, and she fucking gave me so much love. And I'm really grateful about that. And I just loved her so much. And it didn't matter how much time went by. When her and I saw each other again, it was like I just seen her yesterday. And I get so lonely here sometimes that just her sending me a message, you know, like, hey, Sonji, are you okay? Like, that makes a huge difference when you're somewhere that you don't know anybody, you know? And for her to be sick and still find time to check in with me to see how I'm doing, that was a lot for me, because it does give me a sense of, like, you know, she's younger than me, but it feels nice to have that maternal feeling towards you when you never had that before. And it felt good to have that from her. And I still remember her hugs, you know, and the last time we were together and she gave me a hug. And it does feel like that. And I'm going to miss that. I'm going to miss that a lot. So I just think that she was just an awesome person, and I just love her, and I just want to just be grateful and be able to say goodbye and continue to make her proud of whatever I do. And, you know, she messaged me when she moved to her new apartment in November, and she was just like, Sonji, I finally got my own place. I'm so tired of moving all over the place. Can you believe it? I had all these apartments in 1 year. And yeah, I know what that's like. And she was like, all I want is some of your art on my wall. So whenever you make it back to LA, just bring me some art. So I'm still working on her painting. And I'll just, you know, I'll mail it to you guys whenever I'm done with it. And it could be on whatever got walls you guys wanted to be at. But that's what I want to share about her. I just want to share funny things and good things, and I don't want to be sad. I want to celebrate her, and I want to just keep celebrating her and laughing and being silly and stupid the way we always are with each other.
Thank you. That was very beautiful. And thank you for sharing all of that. I'm sure it meant a lot to her. And thank you for sharing that. I understand Lizette has a video of a rally that they both attended. And I want to remind folks, we want to appreciate that all of you have joined us here at Soul Rebel Radio to pay tribute and pay our respects to Soraya Medina, who's a very important member of our community and somebody that all of us have a lot of love for. So if you have it ready to go, Lizette, if you could unmute yourself, and we'll hear some words from Soraya Medina.
There's a lot of us here, and what's nice to know is that there's not just a lot of Puerto Ricans here, there's a lot of Puerto Rican support with our Chicano brothers and sisters. I just want to acknowledge that, and I love that my, you know, my just completely Chicano.
Thank you so much, Lizette, for sharing that, and we'll have another little video at the end where she also shares some words. We're gonna ask Brother Richi, if you don't mind, what can you say about Soraya's love for music and movement in the various communities that she was a part of?
I was actually at that rally that Lizette just was gracious enough to show footage from. And we were part of a Puerto Rican group called Atabe together. And when she was active doing these rallies after the hurricane and all that stuff, she would call and Lizette would reach out to me and a few other people to come and bring music. And when I could, you know, we would, and I would, you know, try and connect with other people and whatnot. But that's where I remember my first memories of Soraya. And being, you know, sharing space with her, we're in Atabe. excuse me. And what I learned, the biggest thing I learned from Soraya, because she was such an amazing presence all the time. The main thing that I learned was that life was about 90% of life is about showing up. And she really embodied that. She would always be present. And she I didn't realize how much she was doing, like all you guys sharing all these stories and how far, you know, she actually reached in different communities and stuff like that is blowing my mind even right now, you know? I'm happy that I know her and that I knew her, because I do feel like Meno said, yeah, she's one of our ancestors now. She's watching over all of us, and I just feel really lucky to have known her, and to be able to have been able to do her politics and whatnot. Like my politics are just, you know, I'm just in bands and I play music, and that's my revolution. But the magnitude of her involvement with stuff, it still blows my mind, and I'm honored to have known her, and through music we just had some really good times and really good performances and whatnot, and I don't know what else to say. I mean, I want everybody to have, you know, moments here, but Miguel, is there anything you'd like me to kind of focus on?
No, thank you. We'll have one more final thought that we'll share, and on that note I wanted to see if Sonji would like to share a final thought, because it's like 4 a.m. in the UK and she was gracious enough to join us. But Sonji, would you like to unmute yourself and share a final thought with the folks and say goodbye?
It's nice. Thank you for inviting me to be a part of this. Thank you everybody that's here. I'm sure Sienna doesn't remember meeting me, but I met her when she was a baby many times. So it's good to meet now grown woman here. Please keep in touch. Neo, I'm happy to finally meet you. I've heard so much about you from your mom. It's funny that the last couple of years I've spent more time with Soraya, with Cindy than I spent with Soraya. We love when she comes and stays here with us. So now you know what my face looks like. So it's nice meeting you. I'm looking forward to meeting your brother Omar too. Your mom says so many beautiful things about you guys. And so thank you for inviting me and letting me participate in this. And I gotta get some sleep, man. So have a good night. I'm sorry I didn't mean to interrupt anybody. Hopefully
we can keep in touch
and everybody can keep in touch. And hopefully something good that can come out of this is that we can all come closer together as a community and as a people, which is exactly what she always wanted from us.
Absolutely. Thank you so much for joining
us. Thank you.
Yaneth, we recently talked about her movement in the community that she's a part of, and I know that she was also a danzante. I think something that's really fascinating to me as a Chicano of Mexican descent is that yourself, who's of Salvadoran descent, and Soraya, who is Filipina and Puerto Rican, like took this on as something that's part of your community as well, right? So can you talk a little bit about your practice as a danzante and what her offering to the community was like?
Thank you, Miguel. Yes, so thank you for asking that question. And, you know, and in answering that question, I have to mention that my relationship with her in danza expanded not just with danza, but as you mentioned, in our chicanismo, right? And our political activism. And even as Richi was talking about earlier, from the LA music scene, you know, we had a lot of different experiences. And when I started danza, and I was, you know, I was trying to remember back when I first met Soraya, and it was back when I met her at Pasadena City College. And actually, I was a freshman at USC at the time, but I had friends that were at PCC. And so I met her through PCC folks, and also through the events that the Mecha at PCC was throwing. Through that, I also would hang out with her and Soraya and Elisa at Imish bookstores. I don't know if any of you remember that, but back in the day, both Elisa and Soraya would talk to me about Danza Azteca. And that's how I started Danza Azteca back in 2000. And she had already been dancing for many, many years. And so I was introduced to danza through Soraya back in the day. And I, the danza culture in LA, it's very structured. You know, there's a lot of different danza communities, and there's you can't just join a danza group, right? You have to be part and be part of it and part of the grupo, and it wasn't just to dance, but it was also a spiritual dance, right? A way to pray and to, you know, pray through danza and through the drums and through the different dances that we were doing. So, that's when I met her back in the day. And then as many of us, you know, we go into different paths in our lives. And I also had stopped dancing. I danced for about 6-7 years. And then I started my master's program and I stopped dancing for a while. But it wasn't maybe till maybe like 3-4 years ago, I saw her again. And, you know, like I think somebody mentioned earlier that when you saw Soraya, it was like if you had just talked to her yesterday, even though I hadn't talked to her in a couple of years. And she remembered everything about where we last left off. And she's the one who got me back into danza, and now I'm back in danza with Jennifer Sanchez, and you mentioned with earlier about somebody mentioned earlier about meeting her through danza with Jennifer Sanchez, and I remember when she told me about it, she encouraged me to do it, and at first I was a little hesitant because it was a different type of danza. It's a theater production using danza to share stories, right? And Jennifer Sanchez developed this group called Indigenous Productions, and in this, I'm sorry, I'm trying to keep this short, Miguel. when she first talked to me about this group, she said, you know, I know that you're used to doing danza like, you know, the other danza groups where, you know, you had a jefe and you had, you know, it was a different culture. But she's like, I promise you that this group that Jennifer's doing is, you know, we're trying to share stories with danza and still keep that spirituality of danza, but use it in a different way to share stories and using a multimedia approach. And so she's really the person who encouraged me to come back to danza and encouraged me to talk to Jennifer Sanchez about this opportunity. And we had the opportunity to dance in several events and here in Los Angeles during Dia de los Muertos, and we danced with Soraya, and I feel very honored to have been able to dance with Soraya. I would say that she was so tiny, but she was so she was fierce, tiny but fierce. I'm very grateful for the opportunity to have had the chance to dance with her and know her in that way, but also not just as a danzante, but like as a Chicana in LA, you know, in all her facets. So, and also I want to say, you know, she always encouraged me in my vision to be a public health advocate. She always saw that in me, and she always encouraged that in me as well. So I needed to also mention that as well.
Thank you. And that's a beautiful photo behind you. Marisol, speaking of spiritual practices, what can you tell us about the spiritual practices of Soraya, and what should the community know about her connection to Creator?
Wow, thank you. That's a really heavy, loaded question, and I hope I can answer it. Of course, you can't give justice to a woman who is so full of light and full of love, and just in the person that she was and the smile that she radiated truly showed the love of Creator. Relatively speaking, I haven't known Soraya that long compared to these other wonderful people on the call. Her and I connected maybe just about 5 years ago. And like everyone said, she makes you feel like you're her best friend, right? And she just had that ability. It just felt like she's just someone who just really got me, you know? And I'm sure a lot of people felt that way. I see people nodding their heads. When you meet someone, it's rare. You just feel like they just get you, and you're like, all right, you're one of us, you know? And that was it. And our friendship just took off. We really, really got close over just the last couple years of her life, actually, and more specifically over the last year of her life. And I really feel like there's some kind of cosmic connection there, you know? Maybe me and homegirl had a past life connection or something, but it really does feel like we were meant to cross paths at such a pivotal time, right? I was becoming a new mom. My daughter's 15 months now, and she was going through what she was going through with her illness and with the moving and the fire in her house and just all these things. And I was going through my own transitions, and we just really connected at both like kind of tumultuous times in our lives. So I feel like the very nature of our relationship was spiritually based, as well as just both being just homegirls who love to get together and talk about boys and talk shit and eat good food and laugh, you know? To have the balance in all things is beautiful, right? And that's the nature of the duality of our spirit, right? As Indigenous people, to hold both of those things, to walk in both worlds. But, you know, like Yaneth was saying, as a danzante, it's part of her spiritual practice. But, you know, I believe that, you know, you could be a danzante, you could be this, you could be that. It's really in the way that you carry yourself and the way you relate to other humans. You can go to all the ceremonies, all the sweats, but you could just be carrying yourself in the world as a foul person, right? Having bad energy and bad relations. And she wasn't like that, just as proof of this small circle here. And then when you look like what her mom was talking about, the ripples, right? You don't create those kind of ripples without coming from a good, grounded spiritual place. So that's proof right there that sister was just rooted, just really strong, and had the love of Creator in her heart. And I believe that we're here to be good to each other, to uplift each other, and to take care of each other. And she definitely did that. Similarly to like what Sonji was saying, how, and Lizette was saying, how Soraya would reach out to them to check on how they're doing with that maternal love. She did the same thing for me, you know, when I was going through my struggles being a new mom during a pandemic and all this stuff. She'd check in on me all the time. I'm like, I'm good. Like, how are you? Like, what I'm going through is going to pass, you know, like I'm going to get over this hump, but how are you? And she just was able to see past her own suffering and struggle to always remember to reach out. Right. And that just always amazed me. She'd literally text me from like her chemo chair. Like she'd call me her hero. Like, how's my hero today? You know? I was like, shit, like, you're my hero. And she's just so strong. And I just admire that in her. And, you know, in the way she promoted health in the community, she really passionately wanted us all to be healthy and to live in a good way like that, and to feed our bodies right, and to treat our bodies right, and to treat each other right. And to me, that's continuing the work of our ancestors, you know, that's walking that sacred ancestral path that she was so passionate about. And it wasn't something she flaunted, you know, it wasn't something that she had to like let everyone know this is what she's about. That was just her, that's who she was. She walked the freaking walk, you know, and she had a lot of talk too, but she backed it up with her actions. In the way that she lived her life, I feel like was just a deep spiritual path, whether she realized it at the time, you know. And when she was very sick at the end, I would just ask her, what can I do for you? How can I support you? And it was always just a simple answer. She just said, prayers. I just want prayers. It's like, all right, sis, I got you, you know. And to this day, and I will continue to pray for her, you know, to pray for her spirit as she makes her transition. And we all need to do that for her, because the way she lived her life was like a prayer for us. She lived her life like a prayer in action. The way she taught her cooking classes and her healthy living classes, that was like her demonstrating what her prayers were for her community and for each of us. You know, like, I want you all to be healthy. I want you all to elevate to healthier eating. The way she respected the ground, like at La Culebra, the way she pushed produce on all of us. She'd bring like so many dope fresh fruits and vegetables to my apartment and cook it up. Like, that right there is a connection to the earth, you know, that sacred connection we have to the earth. She lived it, you know, she cooked it, she ate it. And it was just such an example on how our ancestors walked, you know? And I thank her for that. I'm so grateful for that. There's little things that I've tweaked in my cooking and in my kitchen that are because of her, you know? And, you know, down to the day that she chose to make her transition, or the day that the ancestors called her home, we can see on December 12th, right? That's the day of the Virgen de Guadalupe, right? Or Dia de Tonantzin, you know, very sacred day to Catholics and even those who are non-Catholic, who may be culturally Catholic, or the significance of Tonantzin in our indigenous cultures, right? In our worldview of the divine feminine. And that was the day that she was called home. What a sacred day to make your transition, you know? So that just proves, like, she was needed for a much greater job, you know. It's almost like her spirit got too big for this world, and her work needs to be continued on that higher realm. And we were texting a lot her last week of life when she was in the hospital and stuff. And it was on Saturday. I was like, oh, I got it. You know, I haven't heard from Soraya. I got to text her. And I texted her. I said, Happy Tonantzin Day, sister. And I didn't hear back. I was like, oh, I knew it, you know. It was like she got called home the day of the Divine Mother, and she was the godmother, right? She shared that motherly love to all of us. And, you know, that walk of motherhood in itself is a spiritual path, you know. And she took that very seriously in the way that she mothered her baby. She was Mama Bear. And the way she supported all us women and everyone, you know, and just supported us as women and made us see all our own worth in a way that, you know, a mother can do. And that's what I'll say that much, that was her spiritual walk that I saw. And I was blessed to grow very close to her the last few years of her life, which were a really heightened spiritual time, I believe, to her as she was preparing to transition. I'll say that much. Thank you.
Thank you. Aho mitakuye oyasin, ¿verdad? For all my relations, I think one of the things that I admire the most about Soraya was her ability to convene like so many different communities, and like the way that especially the women in the community came together and rallied sort of around her was really touching and beautiful to see. And yeah, like for me, like when I found out that she had passed away, I'm like, wait a minute, December 12th, man, like she loved Mexicans so much. Like she was like, all right, you're gonna remember me at least every single year on December 12th, which is probably one of our most important and significant days, because we had that same amount of love for her that she had for the Chicano and Mexican community. So it wasn't an accident. I agree. Like it's absolutely, she was called home, you know? And so we wish her a safe trip, and we hope that she's met at the lodge of at the table of creation, and that, you know, that the grandmother meets the grandmother, you know. So thank you for sharing that. The next person I'd like to ask to speak is Lili. And speaking of the outpouring of love, it was really beautiful and touching to see what happened at La Culebra. And I know you and Menoman were there pretty much every day. And I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about what transpired at La Culebra.
Okay. Thank you for asking that. And thank you everyone for sharing about Soraya. And I second everything that you all said. I second the emotion, you know, like really, because I feel everything that everyone has said about her in my corazón. I'm like, yeah, she done that with me too. Yeah, you know, so I could totally relate from the spiritual to the political activism to growing up together through the spiritual. Soraya, for me, when, you know, when she transitioned that day, and I'm going to put this in perspective for myself, and I think I've also, with Cindy, we had the conversation the last day of her vigil at the altar, that day I had an open studio at the night before. Well, I found out, you know, through close contact with Cindy, and then just the next day I had this open studio at my place, and I had an altar for Tonantzin. I had done a prayer ceremony in the morning, a sunrise ceremony dedicated to Soraya as well. We had done a pipe ceremony that day, so it was a constant ceremony for prayers for her to get well and get home with her family. And and so, like, we were in prayer all that day, and then it happened. And then the next day, I was supposed to open up my studio, and I was supposed to have this whole ofrenda y pozoles, open studio, art studio. And for those that don't know, I'm Lili Flor, and, you know, I sell art from my studio for certain holidays. So it was the Tonantzin altar that I also have a manda in my own family that I carry that ceremony. So we did that, and I opened it up. I went that day, and I thought, I was just sick, devastated. I was like on like, I was in a daze. So I got there, and I managed to get there. I knew I had clients coming, and when my first client came in, I was just like, she just looked at me like, and I just couldn't. And she was like, it's okay. I'm sorry, you know, I'm gonna have to close down, you know. And I did, I closed it. And the first thing was, either I go home and I go in a ball in a fetus position and cry all day, or I go and feel connected and still feel like I'm doing something, you know, like to feel a closeness, because now we can't even go run to a best friend and hug each other. I couldn't go to Lizette and hug as friends, or I couldn't go with Mano and say, oh, you know, let's hug, because our sister, you know, we're feeling some way, right? Or even see Cindy or your daughters or anyone in the family, right? You can do that. So the first thing for me was that it's just La Culebra. Like, I'm there. I'm out of here. I'm going to just break down this half of this altar and take it over there. And I said, I want to do a little shrine in the front. You know how they do when people pass away, put a little candle and a couple little things, right? So, but I just, because the way I am, for you, everyone knows who I am, I build altars. So I just took, you know, anything that I could possibly use, right? Flowers, candles, and things like that. So I went over and I said, I pulled in, and there was like already like six, seven people underneath the tree, and there was her friends. Like, it was Iberio, it was Joy, it was Iris, and then a good old school friend, Francisco Hernandez. He had walked all the way from Lincoln Heights. He just automatically just started walking there. They were sitting underneath the oak tree. And then right after I got there was Raquel Salinas, you know. So it was just this automatic magnetism that happened right there. And it was like, this is where I needed to be. And this is, you know, a community. And we just, you know, we hugged, you know. And I know we're not supposed to, but I mean, we didn't, there was no words, you know. So we were there, and then we just kind of like, okay, COVID, you know. And so we have to like get a little control. And so, okay. So they're like, I'm like, you know what? I brought some stuff and I want to put up a little altarcito maybe in the front. So we're like, you know what? let's just do it inside. And so we just started looking, and they're like, we're just going to do it right here. Who cares? You know, like, so everybody started helping, cleaning out that little shed thing that you guys saw. I don't know, everybody, some of you guys that went there. And so it was full of junk, and we just cleaned it out. We set it up. And just real basic stuff. And I just put the basics, and the whole community started adding. And of course I helped to like keep it together, and also build, have a group of community members to come and light up the candles and turn them off. And so the fire was on for 9 days, which was a ceremony. So we decided to say, do we want to collectively? And I asked people that were there that day, should we keep this on for 4 days or should we keep it on for 9 days? Because the caretakers came over, we made the connection that they're like fine with it and all that. So we made sure everything was cool. And they said, cool, whatever, however amount of time you guys want. So everybody said, no, 4 days is not enough. It was, we're on 9 days. And I said, okay, you guys are down. And of course, we had to have this chain where people helped to like different shifts. Like Mano was coming in the evenings. He started coming a couple of days in when we had started. Then he started coming every night, which was really cool. It gave me some time off. And then other people started rotating. And so doing this altar, it's more of a, it's like one of those things where we do as a community, you know, like we put shrines in our homes, right? We put shrines in our communities where people have passed on, right? And so, yeah, she physically didn't pass there, but that was a space that we could connect to, especially during these times of a pandemic and, you know, that kind of thing. And it was a place that we could social distance enough to be able to still be connected, right? And so I set up the altar alongside with other friends, of course, Raquel and Francisco Hernandez that helped initially to set it up. And I, for me, it was just, I stepped into the role, not wanting to, but wanting to at many times, because I know that stepping into these roles like that, especially when it comes to ceremony, holding ceremony for 9 days straight, usually these are 24 hours, right? And it's a big commitment, and it's a lot of work, and it's a lot of, for me, emotional work for myself too. So I had to learn to keep boundaries so that I could also be healthy and safe as well. Because I'm dealing with a lot of other emotions and people coming in the circle, right? And making sure everything works out well for everybody. And in that process, I learned a lot about myself. I learned a lot about our community. I also learned a lot more things about Soraya. I got to meet people that knew her, they came, and I got to meet people that didn't even know her at all, but just heard about her and they felt they just needed to come. I met this young woman. She's like, I never met her. I just wanted to come because I heard from so-and-so friend, and I really felt her spirit. You know, I cried for her, and I cried for her family, and I prayed for her transition. And she was really there genuinely because she felt that love that she gave to everyone. And she wanted to come and be a part of that and help to elevate her to the next level. To the next realm, right? The next world. And there was other stories. There's another young man that works at Semillas as well. He also came in because he found out because of the community. He's like, I want to know who this woman is. And there was a lot, I could say a good handful of people that came in with those type of stories that never met her, that they just wanted to come and give their respects. And that was so beautiful. And I also met people that knew her, that talked stories about her. And we did sunrise and sunset ceremonies. And I gave space to people. And I told people, tell me how you met her, you know, and or one word that describes her. And so I opened space during this time. It wasn't announced, but it was an organic thing. And it was a good time for people to be able to mourn and grieve as a community and be able to connect in that way spiritually, no matter what background you came from. Even though I set up a Northern American, Northern style with some Southern medicine in there, I include also the Taino diaspora, as well as the Afro and her other form of prayer as well through the African diaspora of Bomba and Ifa and Santeria and that diaspora as well. And according to what Cindy told me is also as well that these type of altars are also done in the Philippines for 9 days. And so that was, so it was all, it just happened organically and how it was meant to happen. And I feel that's creator. And that's what Soraya made happen. She made it happen. The perfect space, the perfect little setup. I mean, I had everything. I mean, what Marisol was saying is like, and what I told everyone too as well when we're in prayer, for those that were there and those that weren't, I'm gonna share it again. Soraya left on the 12th. On the 12th that night was a meteor shower. Then you had the eclipse. And then you had the great conjunction. Then you had, which was the solstice, which was Huitzilopochtli. So the birth of the new sun, of the rising sun of Huitzil, of the hummingbird. So, and her name meaning Soraya, the walking through to the magical land of the hummingbirds. Okay, that to me is not coincidence. I do not see these types of things like coincidence. This is the most major astronomical happenings in our lifetime of 800 years. And this is not coincidence. And so through this process, to me, it was like, wow, she left in Soraya fashion. Boom, I'm out. Like, I'm getting crowned. I am going to receive what I'm meant to receive. I am going to transition and I am going to come back and help you. But right now, right? For right now, and that makes me happy. And right now, as being the caretaker of this altar, last night I had a heavy dream and I'm going to share it with you guys right now. And I haven't shared it with anyone.
Please.
I'm going to, as a caretaker too, I have to pray on these things. I also carry medicine, you know, and Marisol knows the Teoshpe. I also dance in the same Teoshpe as her husband. He's also a chief in my Sundance, where I Sundance. So I also have responsibilities with my elders that I have accountability. I have to, you know, check in with them when I'm doing these kinds of things, right? And in the process, I had to get help for myself and prayer and what I'm learning as I go, right? And what I'm seeing, you know. And so I had a dream last night, and the message from her is clearly she came to me, and I didn't expect this. I hadn't dreamt her at all. So she came to me, and she clearly said to stop holding on to her, that we have to let her go. And she actually pointed out to the pictures in my dream, and she got her phone and she said, I don't like this shit. Straight up like this, like that, you know, I don't like this shit, Lily. Like with her whole like attitude. And I was like, oh my God, that she's totally like, and I woke up and I was like, and I know I had to really process it. I did meditation. In the morning, I did like 30-minute yoga. You know, I did all these things to like kind of really, really think about what it was like. She's straight up just telling me we have to let her go because it's time. She's in a good place. She's transitioning, you know, and right now her family is going to give her last rites and ceremony rituals. The funeral rites and services are happening on Thursday. And so that is, she's already asking for us to please already cerrar eso. Yes, completely close it. And it's already happening. I see it happening. But asking other friends to do it as well, to not over idolize her because we know who she is. And I feel right now, later on, and in Northern Way, how we also known in the Northern diaspora of Native peoples from different tribes, and other little different areas, is that after a year, they become ancestors. So calling them right now for help is not the time. Right now is not the time to call them back for asking for help. We have to let her finish, complete her cycle. And usually it's about a year. They say minimal 40 days, but they highly recommend the year before we start asking for her help and start calling her, you know, officially an ancestor. And that's what I really wanted to share. And thank you to the family and Neil, Sienna, Cindy, Omar, Violeta. You know, thank you so much for allowing me to hold space for the community and for yourselves as well. I know that you guys visited the altar. I thank you for giving me the blessing to be able to do that and be able to be the intermediary with the community in that way and take that role. And I took the initiative as well to start that virtual space because I knew that it was going to happen. I, as people know me in the community, I've taken many leadership roles and like I told Neil, I'll swing for my sister. You know, I'll swing in the spiritual realm and I'll swing right here for her because I'm not going to take no bullshit from people. I'm just El Sicona, Habladora, like her. I totally relate, you know. She'd be like, hola, chola, can I call you, girl? I got to tell you something about community. I was like, okay. And so she quit calling me, you know, give me a breakdown. You know, so for her, me, her and I, like, I swung for her, and I know she swung for me in the background in so many ways, from taking care. I mean, it's, I could go on and on, right? But my point is of this conversation is that I am so grateful to have been able to hold space for her because she held space for me. And another thing I wanted to also let you know, Sienna, and I think I shared that with Neil, but I had not with Cindy, is like what Cindy knows because she was there. And so was Neil, but he don't remember, he was too little, that I had met actually your family way before even the Peace and Justice Center in the 90s, because you guys used to live off a rampart right in Ladrisas with my sister, right? And I used to go and do community programming there. Of course, y'all were running around and my sister was having her little community, you know, so we ran into each other. I just didn't connect with her until 1995 when my dad passed away. And I remember her hugging me at my dad's funeral. And we actually just recently, not to know, we were just talking about that. Like, remember, I was like, yeah, I remember hugging her even when she came to visit me this last year. And I visited her as well. We got to cuddle and we got to talk about different things. And I got to be an ear for her. And I, you know, we laughed, we cried, we made jokes, we talked shit. I video chatted so much with her. And she just made my life easier and she made all of ours. And for me, it was like, I didn't have to think about it. And so that's how I feel about that. And I'm so grateful that way. And I thank Creator and I thank our ancestors of that land that were able to let us stay there and also the caretakers right now. So thank you for that platform and for allowing me in that way. I hope.
Thank you for sharing that. Again, thank you and all the women and the community members that were out there to honor Soraya's life at the Culebra. I got to go out there the Tuesday afterwards and got to say my piece and say my goodbyes and stuff. And it was really beautiful to realize that she planted that tree and now it's like, you know, taller than all of us standing together and stuff, right? So I got to meet Soraya at the South Central Farms and I got to interact with her at La Junta and all kinds of different, you know, fun places that she got to, you know, be a part of. 2 years ago, she was here for a party that I had on New Year's Eve, where actually her and my friend Carlos Zaragoza, rest in peace, were both there and now they're both gone. And, you know, part of the inspiration for this was when Carlos passed away, we did something similar because we really wanted the community to understand why he was such an important person and how we came together to rally around the family and to rally around our brothers. Mano was there in support of each other. And so what I saw from the friends of Soraya was just on a whole other level. The way that the women came together was just really touching and to be able to do it for 9 days during a pandemic is just really beautiful and a great tribute to her. And, you know, I have a friend I went to high school with, and she tells me, like, wow, I saw this person, you know, on a bunch of different people's feeds that I know, and I donated money to her, you know, her fund drive and stuff, and I don't even know who she is and stuff. And on that note, we want to encourage anybody who's watching this or who's listening this to look up Soraya Medina's Legacy Fund, because as we speak, as we're recording this, they've raised about $37,000, and we'd like to help them raise some more funds. So we encourage anybody out there who received the Christmas bonus, who had you know, some extra cash in their pocket, who didn't have to buy all kinds of Christmas presents this year, to perhaps donate to the Legacy Fund and help the family out in whatever way they can. So please share not only this video, but definitely please share the Legacy Fund so that we can continue to raise some additional funds for any needs that the family has. And on that note, I'm really honored that Neo, that Cindy, and that Sienna joined us. Sienna doesn't remember all of the times that she met Soraya's friends, because there's like 3,000 of them. But the first time I met Sienna was at an event. I believe it might've been Self Help Graphics. And I'm right there, and oh, what's up, Soraya? I go up to her, say what's up, give her a hug. And she's like, oh, he works on Soul Rebel Radio, Sienna. Maybe you should join that. And I wasn't even trying to recruit her or anybody, but she's over there hustling on my behalf. And I'm like, wow, like, you're cool. And you know, originally our program was designed for young people to learn how to create and produce media. And, you know, now we've expanded. We're going to be on a weekly basis. And now Lizette and Richi and Sonji, who just left the car, are part of our collective that we're trying to, you know, create additional media. So, you know, I want to thank everybody that participated in the Zoom, and I'd like to give Sienna the last word to share with us. What do you want the people to know about your beautiful mother and about the legacy that she left here for us on planet Earth?
Yeah, definitely just want to highlight a lot of things that other people said. She was very passionate about activism and health education and uplifting all the communities she was a part of. And these are things that she really instilled in me growing up. I remember, you know, at the time being dragged to like protests or art galleries or something. And, you know, when I was younger, I didn't fully appreciate it, and I didn't fully understand why we would be doing these things, but now that I'm older, I definitely understand, and I'm definitely really grateful for all those memories and just being a part of movements. Being able to even say I was a part of them because of her is really great. And yeah, she just made an impact on everyone she met. Like, we would go out randomly and she would, you know, strike a conversation with a stranger, and then 10 years later, that stranger is like our family friend or something. And that happened everywhere we went. And it's something I see now in my younger sister. So it's nice that that's still alive and around, because they're both just such like big social butterflies. So yeah, it was just really something that I really admired from her, something that she always did. And definitely kind of like a, I guess, full circle moment is my mom listened to KPFK all the time. And I have like vivid memories of her taking me to school, that playing in the background in the mornings. And I didn't have a phone at the time, so I would know I was late to school because Sonali Cut Hot Cars, her segment would be playing at 8 a.m. And I was like, oh God, I hear the music playing. I know I'm late to school. But I definitely got some good news from there, really informative from a young age. So that was something my mom also made sure I was always informed on topics, no matter how big, no matter how complicated. I was always introduced to a lot of different issues, and mostly like social issues. So yeah, that's something that I would want everyone to know about my mom.
And if you can describe your mama in one sentence or in one word, what would you use to describe her?
Wow, that's a tall order. But she was definitely an influential woman. And one thing I used to call her was a local celebrity because almost everyone knew her. There's people-
Local legend.
Local legend, yeah. I can't even count how many times I've been stopped on the street and people asking me, are you Soraya's daughter? Is Soraya your mom? And my friends know, being around me, that I'm gonna be stopped or something because my mom just had such a huge impact and just such an influence on people that I even get stopped and asked about her. So I'm sure that's something that's not gonna go away, but I'm embracing it now, so yeah.
Well, for what it's worth, I'm sure you've been told 1,000 times, but you look exactly like your mother, and I don't even know her at your age, but I can only assume that you must have looked like her twin at that age. So God bless you, and I'm sure that she's very proud of you and everything you did. And we're really grateful. I'm really eternally grateful that you joined us and that the rest of your family was here with us. So thank you very much. I'm going to go around real quick. One word, everybody, if you can take yourself off the mute. Starting with Lizette, one word or one sentence. Make it short and sweet like Soraya.
Hey, I know she wanted us to work on Earth Guardians. So I just also want to lift up Violeta and her amazing personality, who is also like her mom, and my kid loves her. I know this is a run-on sentence, but Soraya presente.
Sounds good. Man, oh man, I know you got something to say.
Well, I'm going to miss most about Soraya is dancing with her. She was my number one cumbia partner, and she just showed me so much love on the dance floor when we danced cumbias. And shout out to Very Be Careful, her favorite cumbia band, first band she booked, and we'll always remember her in that way. Much love.
On that note, Mr. Richi Panta, talk to us, man. One word, one sentence.
Soraya Medina was the truth.
The truth. That's absolutely true. Yaneth, talk to us. One word, one sentence.
Well, what I want to say about Soraya is that, and what I look forward to is that she planted many seeds, and the ray of sunlight that she reflected on everybody and everybody's life is what's going to make those seeds grow, and it's going to keep growing and growing and expanding, and like somebody mentioned, it's going to keep making ripples in the community. And so I'm very grateful for Soraya's impact in our community in that way.
Thank you very much. Lili, talk to us.
Okay, Sienna, turn off that phone. Hey, just kidding. I'm just so putting you on the spot. I'm just joking. But I definitely want to second the emotion to everybody. You know what I mean? It's like, well, how much more can I say about this badass cosmic flower, magical, chingona, fierce godmother 213? Is that one sentence? Yeah. So I just want to say that she is so much loved, and just how I love her. I'm always going to love her. She'll never... it's this time to have to think there's no such thing as death, only in transitions of worlds. If we put ourselves in that mindset, we're gonna be okay, because she's okay right now. She's moving on into her origin, into her place of origin, and that's where we have to be, and remember her like this in the good light and in good love, and see the reflection of herself in Sienna and Violeta, and nurture her seeds that are here now. And that little Sienna is our little sobrina, is our, you know, our little seed too, as well as the community, and Violeta is too. So the little florecitas, we have to take care of them, and that's our number one priority. So I want to leave with that.
Thank you. Marisol, would you like to share your final thoughts with us?
Soraya was LA's little stick of dynamite, and I'll see you on the other side, homegirl.
Absolutely, man.
Mom,
would you like to allow your mama, if she's still with us, to share a final thought, or would you like to share your final thought?
Mom, did you want to say something?
Oh my God.
Try to keep it 1 to 2 sentences.
Impossible. No, she was amazing. Even as a mother, I'm amazed. But actually, I also have an amazing mother, also called Lourdes. I named Soraya Lourdes after my mom was called Lourdes. She was also an amazing person. She was a judge, but before that she studied astronomy, but because of World War II, she studied. So I felt like I'm a Lourdes sandwich because I was in between two amazing Lourdes strong women. So whatever contribution I have with her, I'm so grateful that my words and wisdom I gathered from my own ancestors I passed on. Because my mom used to say, education doesn't stop just because there are no four walls. A day is not wasted when you learn something new. You always learn every day. So that's why I try to pass on to my kids. So education doesn't have to be formal in a university. Wherever you can get any lessons from the homeless on the streets or like the governor, because my mom was like that too. She would be buddy-buddy with the fisherman or the farmer, and then next day she's hanging with the governor and also the president of my country. And in her time, she was born in 1917, there were very few women who achieved status as a lawyer, and then to become a judge, which is not elected like here in the US. They're appointed by the president. So she always told me there's a difference between elected and appointed. So anyway, she had a great legacy too on my side, and then her Taino roots on her father's side. So she really made us proud.
Yeah, and I'd just like to add to that my sister is a big part of LA history now as she makes her transition to becoming an ancestor of us. And she was very deep rooted in our culture and our ancestors. My grandfather on my mom's side was a World War II survivor of Pearl Harbor and Normandy. And on my father's side, my grandfather was Taino Indian, very proud. And my grandmother has roots from the Canary Islands in Spain. And so just as fierce of a woman as my sister, and just as small. She was just a stick of dynamite till the day she died. So bless her soul. And thank you guys for having us on this platform.
Thank you, everybody that was here. Clearly, Soraya Medina is a product of seven generations that came before her that prayed for her to be here. We want to thank her ancestors that prayed for her to be here with us at this time. We want to thank everybody that's been praying for Soraya, for her daughters, for her family, and for her community since her passing. And we want to say thank you to all of you once again for participating. This was a really beautiful expression of love. And for me, I'm just going to remember Soraya as a fierce little hummingbird. The hummingbirds are my relatives. They're my peoples, my ancestors. I'm sure other folks feel the same way. So, you know, when Soraya comes visits as a little hummingbird, I'll say hello and let her know that we're trying to do the best we can. So we're going to end with some words from her final fundraiser that was done. Shout outs to Very Be Careful, and shout outs to Men Oh Man for helping with the sound that day, I'm sure. And we're gonna end with this. Thank you.
I wanna acknowledge that the way that I know most of you is through activism, and we are activists because there are things happening in our life that we wanna improve. So we are very passionate people, and we're really angry. And I know a lot of you guys from fighting the good fight and the anger. And, you know, I'm an angry person that wants to recover from being an angry person, because anger, no matter how justified, is not good for our health. And we are angry about things that we should be angry about. We should be angry about a lot of the terrible things happening to children and women in the world. We should be angry. So thank you for your anger and the passion. We need to use that to mobilize, because the anger, when it stays in our body, turns into things. And I'm fighting one of those things right now. So I'm learning how to turn this anger into something that we could use so we can keep going forward. You know, I'm only 42 this year, and I want to be older. I always celebrate elders because I'm someone that wants to be an elder too. Yeah. So thank you for making that a reality today. And today is my new birthday.
Thank you once again, everybody. Have a wonderful night.
Thank you, Miguel.
Thank you so much for everything. And God bless you and God bless Soraya's life and her memory. And we'll see each other on the other side, I'm sure, Soraya. Have a good night, everybody. Bye. Bye.